Man up.
Man up.
Man up.
How do I?
How do I?
How do I man up?
By modeling integrity.
Not giving into temptation.
Even if no one is watching.
Doing what's right, even when friends pressure me to do the opposite.
Being willing to serve without recognition, no strings attached.
By loving people.
Being there for my kids, even when work competes for my attention.
Admitting to my wife when I'm wrong.
And then making it right.
Standing up for the weak.
The hurting.
Anyone who faces injustice.
To man up is to surrender.
To trust God for wisdom when I face tough decisions.
To let go of my plans.
In exchange for God's greater purpose in my life.
Give Him the driver's seat, even when I want to be in control.
To man up is to take a stand.
To look at fear straight in the face.
And take courage because the Lord is with me.
To know that God will be my strength in every situation.
To be more like Jesus.
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 That's how I.
That's how I man up.
Man up.
Man up.
Man up.
Man up.
All we want and all we need is found.
worship God today. All we want and all we need is found in Him. His promises are true. He will be there for us. He is present to bring us strength. This next song says, it doesn't matter how I feel, it doesn't matter what I see. My hope will be in you and your promises. So let's sing that to God today. Let's declare with one voice these words. When the weight of life begins to fall, on the name of Jesus I will call. For I know my God is in control, and His purpose is unshakable. Let's sing these words. Doesn't matter. It doesn't matter what I feel. It doesn't matter what I see. My hope will always be in Your promises to me. And now I'm casting out all fear, for Your love has set me free. And my hope will always be in Your promises to me. Amen. Would you tell Him, You will always be more than enough for me. We need You, God. Nothing's gonna stop the plans You've made. Nothing's gonna take Your love away. You will always be more than enough for me. Guys today.
All right, Saddleback. Saddleback, man. What's up? Who's glad to be here? Oh, yeah. So good to see you guys. Wow, this place is awesome. It's packed. Hey, I tell you what. Before we take a seat, let's do this. We're going to give a barbaric yelp. We're going to punch the guy next to us, give him a little fist bump, show the love. Let's say hello to about three or four people around us. Give him an old fist bump, punch him in the gut. You know, do something burly. Awesome. Awesome. And I tell you what, guys, part of manning up tonight is moving on up. If you're in the back over there, I see you all the way in the corner. Move on up. We got some seats here in the front row. I don't know what it is, but men don't like to sit front and center. But if you're sitting in one of those back corners way back there in the bleachers, come on forward. Fill up these seats here. Don't worry. Our guest speaker tonight, Jason Romano, he ain't going to bite you. He's a good guy, and he likes to look at you right in the eye. So come on up. You can move on up. If you're coming on in, go on ahead in. And we got some people online that are watching as well, so we want to say hello to them. Guys, we have got a great night in store for you. You've come on a great night. We've got Jason Romano, who is the recent ESPN senior producer. He's going to be sharing with us about what a walk of faith looks like, what faith looks like in the workplace. So we've got that going on. But as you are coming on up, I tell you what, everyone have one of these? Does everyone have a response card? Go ahead and raise your hand if you don't have a response card or a pen, something to write with, because here's what I'd like to do. I want to preload this right now. Take a few seconds, just like 10, 12 seconds right now, and go ahead and preload. Write down your name, your email, which campus you're visiting from. Most of you, it looks like you're here from Lake Forest. I met a number of you that are here from LA. LA's in the house. We got Corona in the house. We got the Irvines in the house in Anaheim, hooping and a hollering. Okay, so let us know what campus you're coming from. Kind of preload this. And at any point during the evening tonight, take like 20 seconds. Give us your 20 seconds story. You know, what brings you here? What is God doing in your life? Why are you here today, or what are you expecting? We want to know your story, and we want to know how to pray for you guys. So go ahead, let us know that you're here, how we can minister to you guys, how we can pray for you guys. I love it. As you're coming on in, yeah, we got some seats right here in the front as well, over there in the bleachers. And as you guys are doing that, I want to bring out one of my good friends here, Pastor Jim Dobbs, who is the community outreach pastor. He's got a special announcement to share with us. So come on in. Can we give him a big hand right here?
All right.
What up, man? Up. Dude, you're looking buff, man. You're looking buff.
Hey, how many of you guys miss football season?
Oh, yes.
Oh, yes. Man. All right. Well, I got a little bit of trivia for you.
Okay.
We got some prizes. Where's Wilmer? Wilmer's...
Oh,
there he is. He's over there. Wilmer is our community outreach coordinator over here.
Yeah,
he's got some Saddleback swag.
Yes.
So we got some questions coming up here
for
you. Okay, so first one. And this is the last gift right here, right? Last prize. Signed by Rick Warren. Right,
Let me check that out. Guys, this is real. I did not sign this. This is Pastor Rick Warren. It says Proverbs 19:21.
Yeah.
All right. Can I hold on to this?
You can.
Can I take it home?
No, you can't take it home.
Okay, all right.
He's been wanting that. He's been eyeing that thing. So we got to watch him tonight.
He won't give it to me. All right.
He knows all the answers too. So that's bad. Okay. First question. 2017 Super Bowl this year. What number was it? First one.
Roman numeral.
You got to pick. You got to yell it out, man. Okay, over here. 51, right? Okay, easy one. So guess what? What's
it's a warm-up.
Yeah, that was kind of a warm-up.
They don't get the ball for that.
No. Okay, you got to hold on to that to the end.
Okay, all right.
Don't.
Okay,
all right. Stay over there.
You got it, coach.
All right. Something's big. Something big's coming, right? 2 weeks, a little 2 weeks, 2-3 weeks. What's coming up? Easter. Okay, that wasn't, you don't get anything for Easter.
Yes.
You don't get anything for Easter.
Easter. They get a prize for Easter.
No prize
for Easter. Okay, all right. I was going to say.
Yeah, you should know that.
All right.
Everybody here knows Easter's coming up. Important one, though, right?
I see that.
Saddleback's church started, their first service ever at Saddleback Church was on Easter. Okay? Hang on.
Hold your horses, man.
All right, so here's your question. How many were in attendance at the first service?
Dude, that guy literally said, right here, number 43, table 43, he said 200.
Yeah.
That's really close.
That's pretty close.
Yeah. Four people? No, it was not four people. No.
No, no, too high. Wait, this
it's like,
too
it's like a right, bidding war. It's like a bidding war right now. I feel like they might get hostile. You better.
Yeah. Oh, too high, too high.
205, 205.
205, okay,
205.
Who got it? 205. No, he's
picked. You work here, you don't get it, man. You don't get it. I want to give it to that
he's
dude right
picks
there.
Guy. He's a picks guy.
Dude, I want to give it to that
okay,
guy.
Okay, all right, got back 200. Here, back here.
Here, here.
Sorry, Robert.
You want a
sorry,
hat or a bag?
All right, we got to keep moving.
Yeah, we're back. Right there, right that gentleman okay. Right there, table 43.
Right, so Easter's coming up, right? It's our Super Bowl, guys. Right? For Saddleback Church, it's our Super Bowl.
Yes.
Okay?
Yes.
The next 2 weekends, guys, there's going to be some resources. We're going to have yard signs. We're going to have invites. We're going to have these boxes that fold up. You can put stuff in it that you like to give to you know, some guy you work with.
Yes.
So I want to hear from you guys tonight that, hey, you know what? Who am I praying for Easter?
Mm.
Are you praying for somebody you go, they need to be in heaven with me one day. They need to be part of Saddleback Church, right? This is what this is about. So we're hoping and praying. We're praying our community up around here.
That's right.
Right? And we have all these campuses. So next question, here
next
it comes.
Question.
Okay.
This is the last question?
Last year, two questions left.
Two questions, all
right. Last year, last Easter, 17 campuses, not just this one. What was our total, and this is gonna be close, you gotta get close. You won't get this one probably right on the nose. How many do we have in attendance?
65,000.
I heard 63. That wasn't right. 57,000.
You're close. You're getting warmer.
54,000.
Okay. Who said 55? Okay, back there.
Yeah.
54,064.
No.
We got a 54 and a 55. We need
more. Oh, my word.
I already just said what it was.
We just said what it was, Walmer.
Sorry, man.
This is technical difficulty right there. All right, last one.
Okay.
Last question. This is for the signed autograph,
okay.
Rick Warren, Proverbs
19:21. This is for all the marbles right here,
yeah.
Right?
Try to make it so that it's not someone far.
Yeah, you got
to
throw it to
someone like here. So
yeah.
I can throw
and I'm going to push him off the stage if he can't get it to you.
This is
him.
A man up event, and I just feel like it would be embarrassing as the men's pastor if I couldn't.
He did tell me he was a third string quarterback.
Third string. First string punter, string middle linebacker.
So if you're in the line of where this is coming, you might want to duck. I'm just saying, third string.
Yeah, go.
Okay,
ask the question?
Here's the question,
remember.
Right?
All right.
This year, 2017, Easter, in just a couple weeks, right? So you're thinking, what am I going to ask? Right?
Omaha.
No. Is
Omaha.
This year's number, how many years has Easter been at Saddleback? What? Yeah, hold on. Hold on. Oh, we got a winner right here.
Yes, that's what I like, right there. Watch this, all right.
Oh, on the hands, both hands. That should
what,
be
you
a
think
catch.
I was just gonna toss it like that? Come on, man.
So, this year, this is a trick question, because it's 38, right? Because our first Easter, right, was zero. That was the first service.
Come on.
So we're 37 years old, 38th Easter.
Trick question over here.
All right. All right, guys,
so
weekend,
what do you want us to do?
So this weekend, next weekend, you're gonna pick something up. You're praying for somebody.
Yes.
I challenge you guys in this room, pick one person that you're gonna invite to church that hasn't been to church, one person. And there's a ton of resources that you can use. All right? It's gonna be right here after service. You need to get it.
Dude, that guy's trying to eBay the ball right now as we speak, man.
Yeah, I see.
Are you paying attention? You gotta pray for one person, dude. Pray for one person, bring them to Easter, right?
All right, that's it.
All right, let's pray. Right. Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much, Lord. You are a good God, and you have blessed this place, Lord, no one can imagine, Lord. And we just pray for more of your blessings. We pray that every man here, that you would burden their hearts with another man that's not here, and that you would help them to have the courage to be strong and courageous, to stand up and to invite them into your house, into your heart. In Jesus' name, all God's men said, amen. Let's stand up and worship, fellas.
Amen. Let's worship God together. Welcome his presence in this place.
as we sing to him. Can you hear it? A sudden quiet. You can't deny it when the Spirit rushes in. The air is changing, the ground is shaking, anticipating His presence here to dwell. When you fall, all my walls begin to break. Let's sing it. Spirit of God.
Till all my fears.
fears are gone. Sing it out, man. I'm no longer
Amen. Hey guys, can we give the worship band another round of applause for leading us in some worship? All kidding aside, I love that. Go ahead, you can find your seats. I tell you what, I just want another reminder. Go ahead and preload this response card, because at the end of Jason's talk tonight, we want to know how we can pray for you guys. So just keep that in mind. Also, I just want to say this. I mean, we literally have hundreds of you here right now, many more watching online right now as well. And I don't know every single one of you, okay? But I know this. I know that if I wanted to get to know you as soon as possible, as best and accurate as possible, I would ask two people. If you're married, I would ask your wife, what is he really like? If you're not married, and or if you're married, the second person I would ask are your coworkers. See, most of you spend more than 40 plus hours at work, on the job, in your vocation, in your occupation, okay? 40 plus hours. Many of you, it's like 50, 60, some of you 70, 80 hours a week. I was just talking to a buddy of mine earlier today, and we were talking about how it's actually kind of crazy, but the average dad only spends 15 minutes a day with his children. Yeah, that's right. 15 minutes a day with his children. Yet many of you spend 8, 9, 10, 12 hours at work. So if I wanted to know what kind of a man you are, I would ask your coworkers. So here's the question I have for you before we introduce our guest speaker tonight, Jason Romano, and that is this. If I were to ask your coworkers what you are really like, what would they say? In fact, what would your coworkers say if it was your last day on the job? What would your coworkers say if it was their last day on the job and they weren't even believers? What would they honestly say about you? Well, here's the deal. I want you to check out this short clip of what Jason Romano's coworkers, he had been at ESPN for 17 years, what Jason Romano's coworkers who are not believers said about him on his last day of work at ESPN on the Mike and Mike show. Check this out.
To wrap it up for today, guys, please get a shot of Jason Romano
for
us on TV. So today is the last day, not only with us, but at ESPN for someone who's been here just about as long as we have.
Mm-hmm.
He worked on our show 15 years ago and then came back in the last year to work with us as our social media director, Jason Romano. And the one thing I will say about him, of the many that you could, he is the one thing in life that we need more of. He is a genuinely nice person.
Yes, he is.
And he's done a great job for us over
the
years.
He's a good guy. He's done a great job for us. He will be missed. There's no doubt about it. Though he did say he controls our social media, that he's going to put out a really bad tweet and then change the password.
Yeah, the one challenge that I've had with him is he doesn't do a good enough job of screening the handles.
The handles? Yeah.
So if you tweet something really interesting at us, but there's some sort of hidden profanity in the handle, he doesn't notice that.
Well, I think he noticed it, but he's just trying to test you.
Trying to, you know that I like to try and read the people's handles.
He'll
trying to give the love.
He'll read anything that's on the teleprompter.
But he is a person who has a great passion for sports, but he has an even greater passion for his faith, and
he's following that in his next professional endeavor. Incredible person that can leave what he's done for so long because he feels he has another calling. So, Jason, tip of the cap to you. You've been a real asset to this company, no doubt about it. Really, we're going to miss you.
Now, steal multiple things on your way out.
Without question.
Saddleback men, will you please stand with me as we welcome our friend and our guest speaker, Jason Romano. Love you, buddy.
Thanks, brother.
What's up, Saddleback? I felt like I was being eulogized that day, and I wasn't dead. So it was very very awkward to hear that from Mike and Mike, because I have worked with them for so many years and worked at ESPN for so many years, and it was a little awkward to hear so many nice things said about you. We all like when people say nice things about us, right? But when it's your last day and, you know, those two guys took 2 minutes out of their show, which is heard by so many people every day, to say what they said about me, it was very humbling and very nice. So it is an honor to be here. This place is huge, by the way. This is awesome. Like, my church is like 1/4 of this. It's very small. And I'm from Bristol, Connecticut. Anybody ever been to Connecticut in here? Not a lot of hands. I didn't think so. I live in Connecticut still. That's where I live, 10 minutes from ESPN. And when Tom called me and asked me to come here, I was very, again, humbled by it, and I'm thankful to be here. And it was a great run at ESPN. My last day there was that video that you saw. That was February 10th of this past year, and it was a good run. But it was time. It was time to, in some ways, just say yes to God. It was a calling that I have felt for a few years to potentially leave ESPN and kind of start a new trek, a new career, a new venture in ministry, and I'll talk about that in a little bit, but it was time, and it's been a great run, so I'm thankful for all the time I spent there. But the interesting thing was, I'm gonna go back a little bit for you guys and tell you a story of how I got to ESPN, because it almost didn't happen. So in 1998 was the very first time that ESPN even entered the possibility of me going there, and I had been out of college for about 6 months, and I was working at a local radio station in Albany, New York, where I'm from. That's where I grew up, in Albany. And I was going online one day, and all of a sudden, I see a job opening for a producer at ESPN Radio. And I was like, you know what? I'm going to apply for this job. Why not? Now, the job description said you needed 6 years' experience, and I had about 6 months. But I said, what the heck? I'll try. So I applied for the job just thinking nothing of it. And this is in the day when the internet was still in its infancy. So I honestly didn't even think that they would call me because I didn't really know how this whole job application online worked, right? Nowadays, it's much different. But in 1998, who knew what was going to happen? Well, guess what? I got a call from ESPN, and they said, we would like for you to come to Bristol, Connecticut to interview for this radio job. And I just thought it was a prank call by like one of my coworkers or something. I said, you are not serious, are you? And they said, yeah, come to Bristol, Connecticut, and we'd love to meet with you. So I got in the car, I went out there, I talked to about three people, and immediately when I got there, I just knew that this wasn't going to work. Like, it's not that I didn't want to work there, I just knew that they were looking for somebody with a little more experience. I mean, I had 6 months experience coming out of college, so there wasn't a ton. Needless to say, the experience was amazing for me, just even interviewing at ESPN, but I didn't get the job. And they sent a letter, which I still have, by the way, in some scrapbook packed away in a box that says, Dear Jason, we regret to inform you that we are not able to bring you on as an employer of ESPN at this time. And I just kind of said, okay, that's fine. I didn't think I was going to get the job. Fast forward, now I got married in November of 1999 to Dawn. We're still together after almost 18 years, which is great. Thank you. I don't think she's watching right now, but I love you, Dawn. How's that? A little shout out to my wife. But we got married in 99, and I was working still in local radio. And then we go about 4 or 5 months later, and we move into this small little house. We're just starting marriage, guys. If any of you are married, you know that beginning stages. You're just trying to get off on a good foot. You know what I'm saying? Make sure everything's going well. And we end up in this little small house, you know, for us, just a little two-bedroom house. And I go to work one day, and I go online. The same job is back at ESPN Radio. Producer, 6 years experience, Bristol, Connecticut. And I'm like, well, I got 2 more years experience now. What the heck? I'll apply to this job. So I apply. I go home that night, and I tell my wife, I say, Dawn, I know we literally just moved into this house like a week before. I say, I know we just moved into this house, but I want you to know that maybe 2 months from now, we're going to be moving out of this house and we're going to be moving to Bristol, Connecticut, because I'm going to go work for ESPN. All I did was hit send on an application. We hadn't even got a call back yet. But I said this to her jokingly, hoping that it was planting a seed in case they actually did call back and this became a reality. And my wife just looked at me and said, you're nuts. What are you talking about? Like, we just moved into this house. We're not moving to Connecticut. Where is Connecticut? I don't even know how far away is that from here. She had no idea. And I said, well, it's 2 hours, and it's an easy ride right on I-84, no problem. You know, I'm giving her all the details. But then I knew that we were sort of joking, but I had planted the seed. So ESPN does, in fact, call about a week later, and they say, we'd like you to come out to Bristol. Similar situation as the first time in 1998, right? So they asked me to go out there. I go out there. I get to Bristol, and this time it's a little different because this time I got the tour of the campus. By the way, ESPN's campus is like this campus. This is a campus, guys. There's like 15 buildings and architecture and just amazing things to see at Saddleback. ESPN is very much like that. Has a lot of buildings, has a lot of architecture, studios, first class, everything is awesome. So I get there and I get the tour, but then I sit down with 3 or 4 different producers. And I can hear in their voices, like, this is a little more serious. Like, they actually think I have potentially the skills to get this job. So I go there, have a great visit. It was like 4 hours long. They were quizzing me on what I knew about sports. Like, this was much different than the first time I went there. So I go home, and my wife knew I was going, obviously. But I go home and I say, hey, Dawn, this was awesome. This was a great interview. I don't know how serious they are about the job, but it seemed to go pretty well. So this was end of April 2000. I didn't get a call for another month. So it was end of May of 2000. They call me back, finally. So I had just dismissed it by this time. And they say, listen, Jason, we were really impressed with you. And I think we want to hire you, but it's down to you and one other person for one job as a radio producer. So we want to just give you a heads up. This is where we stand. And we'll let you know what happens. I'm like, okay, I am down to the final two here. I don't know if you guys have ever gone for a job and knew you were like down to like the final two or three, but that's just that moment where everything's kind of flowing through your brain. What if I get it? How much are they going to pay me? When are we going to move? How's this all going to work, right? And this is a job, obviously, 2 hours away. So I come home and I tell my wife, I'm like, Dawn, I'm down to the final two here. Like, this is serious stuff. Like, this ESPN thing might become a real thing. And she says to me, hold up a second, hold up. You ever have your wife tell you just hold up a second? All the time, right? 18 years of hold up. And I love my wife. And this is why I love her. Because she said, we have to talk about the parameters that we need to put on this situation here. How much they want to pay you. What we're going to put some parameters on this. Because we can't just go out there. Now, in my brain, I'm like, they could offer me $1. $1 and I'm going. Like, this is ESPN, guys. This is not, you know, your typical run-of-the-mill place. But in her brain, she's like, we have to have certain, some criteria here to get this job. So she says to me, I said, all right, well, what's it going to take? How much are we looking at here? Now, at the time, guys, I'm making about 20 grand a year. Not a whole lot of money, you know? But I loved what I was doing. I was in local radio. We lived in a small, like I said, small house and whatever. Money wasn't the object. It was just the opportunity to work in the business I always wanted to work in. So I said, what's it going to take, honey? And she looks at me and she goes, you know, they need to pay you $38,000 a year. I said, $38,000? That's such a weird number. Why 38? She's like, it's just what I feel, $38,000. Now, let me preface this, guys. I was not, neither was my wife, a Christian at the time. So we weren't like God-believing, like we're going to pray about this. It was none of that. It was just kind of like what we were thinking. So she says, $38,000. That's what we're going to say. And I said, what else? Anything else? She's like, they got to pay for us to move to Connecticut. I'm like, it's 2 hours away. We could just get a U-Haul. She's like, no, they got to pay for our travel. I said, that's pretty exact parameters you're putting on this thing, right? I said, okay, 38 grand and moving to Connecticut. If that's what it is, that's what it is. Now, in my brain, guys, if they were going to offer me 12,000, like I said, or even a dollar, like I was going to go begging, please, honey, can I just have this job? Because I was dead set. Like, I wanted to work at ESPN, you know? ESPN calls about a week later, and they say, listen, Mr. Romano, you know the two people that we wanted to hire were you and one other person? Well, and ESPN doesn't do this, by the way, anymore. But they said, what we've done is we've created a second job. So we have one producer job open for you. We have actually found somehow, some way, to the ability to create a second job. Again, that's very difficult to do now with HR and kind of getting headcounts and money and all that, if you guys know business. But in 2000, apparently, it wasn't as difficult because they found a second position available, and they said, what we would like to do is hire both of you. So I'm like, yes. And then I calmed myself down. I said, are you offering me a job to work at ESPN? He said, yes, sir, we are. And I said, all right, how much are we paying here? How much are we talking? And this is my lips to God's ears. He says, we're going to pay you $38,000 a year. That's the salary. That's the truth, guys. Hold on, it gets better. Hold on. And I said, what about anything else, benefits, anything else? Like, well, you're going to have your full benefits. Disney owns ESPN, so you get the full Disney experience with the benefits. And we're going to pay for your moving expenses to come to Connecticut. And my eyes lit up, and I said, I accept. Guys, if you're married, never accept a job without actually talking to your wife beforehand. It's just a piece of advice, but I did. And then I figured I was okay because she had set the parameters, right? And they met them right on the nose. I couldn't believe it. Imagine if they had said $37,950. What do I do then? I'll have to call you back. I'm sorry. Like that wouldn't, I don't know. What would I have done? But 38 on the nose is what they offered, and that's, I said, I accept. So I come home that night, or my wife comes home, I was already home, and I say to her, Dawn, guess what? ESPN called and they offered me the job. She goes, well, did you accept it? I said, I did. She's like, I thought we talked about this, the parameters. I'm like, well, are you ready? I said, sit down. She goes, all right, lay it on me. I said, they're gonna pay me 38 grand a year, that's the salary for the job. And she's just like, no, they're not, you're kidding me. I'm like, Dawn, on the nose, $38,000. She goes, what else? What about the moving expenses? I said, they're paying for the moving expenses too. And she just looks at me. She goes, seriously? I said, yeah. And she just starts crying. Because that was the moment she knew that we were moving to Connecticut. And that was it. How crazy is that? ESPN called 38 grand. It was just, and like I said, we weren't believers, but if you look back at that story, like, tell me that wasn't a fully lined in God's will moment. You know what I mean? Like, that could have been $1 off, and who knows if I would have ever been able to go to ESPN. You just don't know. So that's how I got to ESPN. It's a pretty crazy story because they put that number right on there. And it was awesome. It was great coming to ESPN. It was great. I was like a kid in a candy store. I mean, if you guys are sports fans, you know, like ESPN is where you turn the channel on every morning when you wake up, right? Or the radio station or whatever. And for me as a kid growing up, like that was the thing, the place, the show. I used to tape highlights from Chris Berman on my VCR when I was in college and high school watching I'm a Cowboys fan, by the way. I don't know if there are any Cowboy fans in here, Dallas Cowboy fans, but there's a couple, okay. You can hate me later if you want, let me finish. No, but I used to tape like all these highlights. I was an ESPN junkie as a kid, so to be able to work there was like, it was truly a dream come true. Now people ask me, is this your dream job? Not really, because I never thought ESPN was even remotely possible to get to. You know what I mean? I was completely content working local radio and being a producer and doing all that, but ESPN, you gotta be kidding me. So begin the ESPN career, and again, I'm not a Christian at this time. So I'm at ESPN and I'm doing my thing. The very first job I ever worked on was Mike and Mike in the Morning. Now Mike and Mike had just come on the air as that duo 6-7 months earlier. So I'm on the show and it's in its infancy stages. It had just started. It wasn't nearly what the show is now. Back then it was three people working on the show, myself and two other producers, and then Mike and Mike. And we were in this little tiny studio. I mean, it was barely enough room for more than two people. It was real tiny. When I left ESPN 7-8 weeks ago, we had 25 people working just on Mike and Mike, and the studio was half of this room. Like, it was just that you kind of see the trend, the evolution of that show. So when I first worked on it, it was great. We were just starting out. We were having a blast. I honestly went to work every day like, this is just the greatest thing that could ever have happened to me. Like, my wife, God love her. I mean, I probably neglected her way more than I should have as a husband because I was laser focused on Mike and Mike and ESPN. And that was my life. That was my identity. That's who I wanted to be. That's who I was. That's how people thought of me. That's the ESPN guy. And I loved it. I was eating it up. This is the coolest thing ever, man. I work at ESPN. We get to Mother's Day 2001, and it's a long story, so I'm just going to share the very brief moment when I was in a bedroom with my brother, Chris. I have two younger brothers, Chris and Damien. Chris is now a pastor, but he was also the first in our family to become a believer in Christ. And Chris sits me down in a bedroom at his house in Hudson, New York, on Mother's Day 2001, and shares with me this gospel of Jesus Christ that I have never understood or heard before. I had gone to church as a kid, going to church in Catholic church and different other churches, and I went because I was kind of forced to, or my mom or dad or even my grandfather made me, but I didn't understand what the gospel was until that day. And he shared it with me, and I accepted Christ into my heart and began my Christian walk. It was a great day, a great day. But then I had to go back to work at ESPN. So what does that look like? Well, for me, for a very long time, it looked like ESPN, Christian faith, husband, and eventually becoming a dad to Sarah in 2004, that was my life separate. So I would go into work. I love my job too. Like, I did a bunch of things. I was a radio producer for Mike and Mike, then I moved on to a different show, did radio for 4 years, then moved on to TV. I was a TV talent producer. There's a picture there of me with Emmett Smith and Colin Cowherd. That was a great job. I loved my talent producer job because I got to work with different people all over the industry of sports and athletics and things like that. It was awesome. So I got to be a talent producer for almost 9 years, and it was great. But again, my identity, who I was, and what I thought about everything that had to do with me was so focused on work that I was neglecting my family. I was neglecting, in some ways, my faith. I was really just focused on ESPN. My phone, as we started to get into the age of cell phones and electronics, like, that became a problem. Anybody understand that with their work, like just staring at your phone all day long? I still struggle with that very much. But this whole work thing became who I was. I was consumed by it. I wanted to do the job and do it well. And then 2010 comes along. So this is about an 8 to 9 year period, guys, of being a Christian and not understanding how to live what I understand now as a believer at the workplace, in the workplace, because I was separate. It was work was work, and my faith and my belief in Jesus and everything that comes along with that, my church family, that was separate. That was when I went home. So 2010 comes along, and it's a day where I find out
that I'm going to be spending the day at ESPN with Tony Dungy. Do you guys all know who Tony Dungy is? So he's a head coach. Yeah, you can clap for him. He's awesome. That's Tony Dungy right there. And that's Nathan Whitaker, his co-author on the left. He's great, too. I love Nathan. But Tony not only coached the Tampa Bay Buccaneers, he coached the Indianapolis Colts, and he coached them to a Super Bowl title in somewhere in 2007. And Tony Dungy, and I remember watching this, and you guys may remember this too, when he won the Super Bowl, he's on the podium receiving the Vince Lombardi trophy in front of 150 million people worldwide watching him. And who did he give the glory to when he won that trophy? Not to his teammates, not to himself, not to his family. He gave it to God. And I remember watching and thinking, that is awesome. Like, this man understood the platform. And I talked to him about that a couple times when I've met him, and he said that was fully planned in his mind. If this happens, the glory that I'm giving in my platform is going to God. And he stood up there and he said, all praise to God. We did it the Lord's way. This is awesome. And that was just great, right? So I know Tony Dungy's coming to ESPN, and he's promoting his book called The Mentor Leader. So I brought the book with me. And I said, all right, this is going to be great. I'm going to get to spend the day with Tony. So my job at the time as a talent producer was to bring Tony in to set up a schedule of all the different shows that he would walk to and from in Bristol, Connecticut, he would be on. So he was on Mike and Mike. He was on SportsCenter, NFL Live, The Herd, all of these other shows that were on ESPN at the time. So I set up a schedule for him, and my job is not only to set up a schedule and coordinate him coming to Bristol, but then to walk him around and take him from show to show. And I'm not going to kid you guys. Like, whenever we had somebody of Tony's stature, I got excited too. Like, this is Tony Dungy. And I know my job, and you have to be professional, and you got to do your thing. But you still get excited when you're hanging out with somebody, you know, who's seen on TV and a head coach and got a lot of, you know, a lot of people that follow him and know all about him. So Tony Dungy comes to ESPN. He brings along Todd, one of his assistants, and Jessica, his second assistant. And I tell you their names for a reason, especially Jessica's. So Tony comes, and I knew that I was going to talk about matters of faith with Tony at ESPN. Like, that's what I wanted to talk to him about. It's very easy to talk to him about sports and what was it like to coach Peyton Manning and how cool is it to win the Super Bowl. I don't know why, but for me, I wanted to say, like, how did you become a man of faith? Like, what is it like being a coach and a Christian in the locker room? Like, I wanted to ask him questions like that, because I knew those weren't the questions that everybody was going to ask him on SportsCenter or on these other shows. So I wanted to ask him about his faith and about who the man that he was and the husband that he was and the father that he was. So we have great conversation going. We're walking him from show to show. And then all of a sudden, Tony stops me and he says, Jason, I just got a question for you. How do you live out your faith in the workplace? Because he knew I was a believer, obviously, and we talked about Jesus a little bit. He says, how do you live out your faith in the workplace? And I was caught off guard by that question. And I said, Tony, or coach is what I called him, I think. I don't call him Tony. Mr. Dungy, maybe. But I said, I don't even know if I'm supposed to be here, coach. Now, in my mind, for probably the last year or so, I started to think, am I supposed to end my life, my career working at ESPN? Am I supposed to be there for the rest of my life? You know, like, as far as I'm going to work? Or is there something bigger? Is there something more? So at that time, I was really wrestling with the idea of potentially wanting to go somewhere else and not be at ESPN. I don't even know if it was a calling, you know, or anything like that. It was just something that I felt kind of like maybe my time is running out here. It had been almost 10 years being there. And I answered Tony's question simply with, I don't think I'm supposed to be at ESPN anymore, coach. I said, I think God might want me somewhere like in a sports and faith ministry, like Fellowship of Christian Athletes or Athletes in Action or something like that. I said, I don't know if I'm called here right now. And Jessica, I love Jessica. She's awesome. Jessica walks in front of Tony, and she just comes up and she just stares at me like a stern mom looking at her son who had just came home with like a terrible report card or done the worst thing your kid's ever, you know, the look that you give a kid. And she just looked at me and she goes, and I'm looking at her, I'm like, what did I do, Jess? She goes, you don't get it, do you? And I said, what don't I get? I don't know what you're talking about. She's like, look around you. And I said, we were in a studio. I was like, all right, I see 20 people. She's like, I said, no, look around you. Look at the place you're at. There's 4,000 people at ESPN right now in Bristol, Connecticut. She said, imagine
this as a mission field. And look at all the people that you can, you know, interact with, that you can be a light to, that you can impact. And I said to her, oh my gosh, you're right. And it was like a light bulb kind of just brightened up above my head. And I said, you're right. You're so right. And she said something that really stuck with me, and I still share it today. I share it a lot on my social media pages and things. She said, you need to bloom where you were planted. And right now, your purpose is you're planted at ESPN. And until God calls you away, and he will make it clear to you when he does, you are to be a light and you are to be an example of Christ here where you are in the workplace. And I was like, this woman is preaching to me right now. Like, this was awesome. But I was also kind of taken back by it. But it changed my life. It truly changed my life, and it changed my outlook and my focus on how I was going about my job every day. So before that, it was work, and then it was the rest of my life. After that, and I really started digging in, there's a, you know, John 3:30 was something that's on your guys' cards, I think, too, and it says, he must increase, he must become greater, and I must become less. And that really stuck with me, like, wow, okay, I need to become less here and stop thinking about me and what I want to do, and God needs to become greater in my life. You know, the Great Commission says to go into the world and preach the gospel to all the nations. Jesus is talking about it, right? And I think Jesus meant literally all of the world and all of the nations. So that doesn't mean in a church or even at your house. That's everywhere, guys, and that includes our workplace. So that really opened my mind up to, like, all right, I want to find out how to be a better Christian in the workplace. How do I be more of a witness for Christ in the workplace? And I'll tell you one thing I couldn't do was I couldn't grab my Bible and put a big cross on my chest and start saying, guys, repent. You're in trouble if you don't. Like, I can't do it. If I did that, I would have gotten fired on the spot. Like, that would have been the end of my, if I wanted my career at ESPN to end, that's an easy way to do it. Like, I was not hired to do that. And there's a great quote from Martin Luther. It says, the Christian shoemaker does his Christian duty, not by putting little crosses on the shoes, but by making good shoes, because God is interested in good craftsmanship. And man, that quote just nailed me in the head like Rocky Balboa with a right hook. Like, it just woke me up like, oh my gosh, that's it. Like, that made sense to me. Just because we're Christians doesn't mean we gotta put little crosses on everything we do. It means we're called to do good work. What's Colossians 3:23 say? Whatever you do, work heartily as for the Lord, not for man. Work at it with all your heart as though you're working for the Lord and not for human masters. So it means, what are we called to do at work? Man, we're called to work our tails off and do a good job right where we are. And I know, guys, that it might be a tough, you might say, you don't know what I'm going through at my job. And I understand that. I've had tough times, believe me, in my job. Had tough bosses that I didn't get along with. You might say, oh, my boss, you don't even know my boss. I get it. But until you're called away to something else, God has commanded you, not called you, commanded you to be a witness for him right where you are, to be a light right where you are. So how do we do that? Guys, I'm not the most intelligent guy. My vocabulary is not PhD or even like master's degree level type vocabulary, so I try to keep things fairly simple. So I got two simple ways to do this. It's very simple. Number one is to simply love. Love the people you work with, because that's what Jesus did, right? He loved the people he was around. Even the people that were spitting on him, mocking him, slashing him, everything they were, he was loving them. And again, I know that's not easy, because I remember a time when I was having a difficult moment with my boss, and I was like, I gotta get out of this job. I just don't like this guy. I can't deal with him. And one of my coworkers, who was a believer, came up to me and she's like, let me ask you a question. Have you prayed for this guy? I laughed at her. I said, are you kidding me? I'm not praying for this guy. No way. She's like, Jesus would pray for this guy, you know, because he said he died for everyone. I was like, stop telling me that stuff. I don't want to hear that. What are you talking about? But she was right. We're called to love the people we work with, even the people that we can't stand. The second one is, again, very simple, to serve. We're called to serve. So if we go into our jobs every day with the mentality of loving and serving the people that we work with on a daily basis, the formula equals one word simply, relationships. That's the secret sauce, guys, to being a Christian in the workplace and sharing your faith. You can't walk in with a big Bible and a cross and start telling people that they gotta move towards Jesus. They're just not gonna respond that way. But relationships, simple, simple, simple relationships. But it's hard too, right? Because this guy's driving me nuts over here at lunchtime, chewing real loud and kind of saying some words I don't want to hear all day long and kind of talking about some things that I shouldn't be listening to. But I got to be intentional about maybe trying to build a relationship with this guy. Because when we build relationships with people, we get to know about them, right? We get to know about their family. We get to know about their likes, their dislikes, what sports teams they root for. And once we do that and they get to know you, they're going to say, tell me more about you. Guess what? You just got an opportunity to share your faith. Now, you don't have to go hard on strong and say, listen, this is what's about me. There's this guy named Jesus, and he saved me. You might not want to go that route real quick, but you might talk about your faith. You might talk about how you've changed as a person because you accepted Christ. You might talk about simply your church. I go to Saddleback. This place is pretty awesome. You should come check it out. There's no judgmental people here. There might be. We're all judgmental. We're all hypocritical in the sense that you're trying to just let people know about you. Simply building relationships. Guys, it's the simplest formula. 1 Peter 3:15 says, though, if we build these relationships and we get to know people, that we always need to be prepared. And I know there's other parts in here, but it says, always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. But do this with gentleness and respect. So there's two levels here. We need to be prepared, guys. So we need to be in the Word. We need to be praying. We need to be fellowshipping with other like-minded people who believe in Christ. And we need to grow in our faith that way. But then we need to be prepared. So if somebody's going to ask you a question, you want to be prepared for that answer, right? So we need to be prepared to share the hope that is in us. I like to do it this way. I'm not going to tell you what you need to believe, but I'm going to tell you what Jesus did to me. And then you can believe whatever you'd like. But because we built that relationship, that's going to be my opportunity to open up to that person and talk to them and get to know them. And the second part of that verse, the very, very, very end says, do it with gentleness and respect. That's hard for us sometimes, right? Because we're like, don't you just get it? What is wrong with you? Don't you see? Look what he did for all of us. But gentleness and respect. So we need to keep that in mind as well. I'm going to finish up in a minute here and then bring Tom back out. But so what does that look like, right? Being a Christian in the workplace, it looks like a bunch of things, but it's simply building relationships. And as I built those relationships, I really saw God move in a place like ESPN. You know, we started a little fellowship group a few years back with one of the girls I worked closely with. This is actually a picture from the very first fellowship group we ever had. And there's 7, 8, 9 people. I don't know if you guys recognize the guy in the middle. Bobby Bowden, that's right. Florida State legendary coach Bobby Bowden. He happened to be at ESPN that day. He's also a very strong believer in Jesus. And his assistant, who, by the way, was Jessica. Remember Jessica? Looks at me in the eye and tells me I don't get it. Jessica was there that day. And she says to me, how you doing, Jason? What's going on? I said, we started a fellowship group at ESPN. Just where people get together, we pray, we talk, we read the Bible a little bit, we kind of give a message, but really it's just about doing life together. Your jobs may be like mine. It consumed us. Even after we knew how we were supposed to be as Christians in the workplace, your job can consume you. You heard Pastor Tom say 40, 50, 60 hours a week. There are weeks I put in 70, 80, maybe even 90 hours a week doing my job. It's not fun. And I got a daughter at home who's almost 13 now, my wife, like they've put up with a lot by me putting my job, the way I put my job in there. But we had that fellowship group, and it was just a way to get away for an hour every 2 weeks and just come together, relationships. Bobby Bowden also happened to be there, and Jessica told Bobby about what we were doing. He's like, I'm gonna come and speak for 5 minutes. He came, and he shared the full gospel with us in 5 minutes. Guy was 84 years old or whatever he was. I think he's like 86 now, 84 years old, and he comes and he just shares the word for 5 minutes and we're all mesmerized. It was awesome. It was so great. But there are ways to do this. But guys, for me, it was, you know, what does faith look like? Faith always means risk. I got that quote from a certain pastor that you guys might recognize, Rick Warren. As I left ESPN, I put on my Facebook page, I shared like a little thank you for, I wanted to recognize the people that impacted me in my journey at ESPN and impacted my life. There was a lot of people, but there was a good core of 14 or 15 people that I wrote this long, long, if anybody read that Facebook post, it was like reading a book. Like, I just say thank you for reading it, because I'm sorry it was long, but it was my, I had to write it. I had to thank as many people as I could for all the time I spent at ESPN. And in that post, I put that quote, faith always means risk. And I believe, for me, having to say yes to God and leave ESPN was a risk. It's a risk right now, because I was stepping out into something that was a bit of an unknown. Now, I left ESPN, I'm going to work for a sports and faith ministry now. We'll talk about it a little bit in a while with the Q&A with Tom, but long story short, I left ESPN to go and be into ministry and do more for the Lord, to take the skills that I had acquired for 20 years at ESPN and other broadcast areas and just give it back to God somehow, some way. So thank you. And we're going to bring Tom out. This is the part where I think you guys have some questions to ponder as you get ready for the table talk, and Tom's going to come out.
Awesome. Hey, can we give Jason another big round of applause? Good stuff, my man. Love it. Love it.
Thanks, brother.
Now, guys, the next 10 minutes is arguably the most important 10 minutes of this entire evening. A lot of times we believe that circles are sometimes better than rows. Right now, you'll notice that you are seated in circles, in these round tables, rather than rows. And here's the deal. It's because that we can't do life alone. We need to do it with each other. We talk about accountability, even mentorship, even learning from others. And so, Jason, I think you've got three discussion questions for us. Can you go ahead and read them out for
us? The first question, guys, is simply this. What does sharing your faith at work look like for you? Because your workplace might be different than my workplace. My workplace has 4,000 people. Yours might have 20. By the way, my workplace now has me. I'm in my bedroom in a spare room with an office, and that's it. So what is faith in your workplace?
But you got your boss there. You got your wife
there. I do have my... You know, the boss is the boss.
Okay.
You put parameters on this next phase, too. Trust me.
Exactly.
But what does sharing your faith at work look like, guys? Yeah. Second question. Do the people, and this is a big one, do the people you work with know you are a Christian?
Now, do you try to hide it?
I don't want to be sort of in your face here, but I really believe this. If the people you work with have no idea that you are a Christian or that you believe in Jesus, we're doing it wrong. We're doing it wrong. Something's not right here. And it doesn't mean, like, again, you walk around with your Bible, but I mean, raise your hand if you're on social media in any form, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. Raise your hand.
All right, most of us.
Most people here. Guys, that's an easy outlet right there to share your faith.
Yeah.
And you're probably friends with people you work with, right?
Right, right.
It's very, very easy. You could even post something about being here tonight.
Do the people you work with know you're a Christian?
Gotcha. Do the people you work with know you're a Christian? Mm-hmm. Number three.
Last one.
What is God calling you to say yes to right now? Now, for me, it was saying yes to leave ESPN. Now,
that's
hopefully, he's not calling all you guys to leave your jobs today. I hope he's not.
Yeah.
But he might just simply be saying, you know what, you need to say yes to talk to that guy at the cafeteria table that he sits next to you every day and you don't say anything to him.
Right.
Tomorrow, it might be an opportunity for you to just say hello.
Right.
Again, we talked about relationships, right? So it could be as simple as, what is God calling you to say yes to right now? It might be as simple as that. So.
That's a dangerous question.
It's a dangerous question.
So here's the deal. We're going to give you guys 5 minutes. We want you to choose one to discuss around your table right now with the fellows right there. Designate kind of a table champion, if you will, a captain of your table, a captain of your huddle there, and share the answer to one of those questions right now. We'll give you guys about 5 minutes. We'll turn on some Spotify, and then Jason and I will be coming right back out for a rapid-fire question and answer.
Awesome.
All right. God bless,
guys.
Thanks, guys. Give you guys 5 minutes.
The name is, you forget what the reason you were playing the game is, and it's all an illusion, a 21st century institution, and so I'm headed down the open road unknown, and we find what we're made of, through the open door, is it fear you're afraid of? What?
looking for the rhyme and reason. Why you born, why you leaving? What you fearing, what you believing? Why you living and breathing? Why you fighting it and getting it even? Let's go headed down the open road.
All right, give it a 1 minute warning here. 60 second shot clock, yeah?
60 seconds?
60 second shot clock.
That's like 1983 North Carolina State right there.
Dude.
Princeton basketball.
Princeton basketball. Yo, that's New Jersey right there.
It is New Jersey.
It's New Jersey.
I've been to New Jersey
Princeton
once or twice.
Tigers. That's the promised land. No, actually, it's not. Nobody's listening right now, so that's okay.
It's good. They just hear blah, 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 blah.
Oh, that's my good. Gosh. See, this is a good thing when men talk.
Love it.
They're actually talking. Look at this. Praise the Lord.
There's
talking,
one guy not talking.
Conversing.
Right up there. No, I'm just kidding.
There's one guy up there,
up there
in the bleachers.
Corner.
Dude, that's the band
don't
right there.
Don't bother me.
That's
the band. There you go. They don't talk to each other. They
the
just play music.
The band don't talk. They just too cool for school. Yeah.
Everybody wants to be a musician.
Some of these men, I promise you, I've never seen them talk before, so that's a good thing.
I love it.
You got them talking, man.
I see a lot of jerseys. I see a Adrian Peterson jersey over there. Is
AP
that what that
in
is?
The house.
Vikings fan?
Yeah. Okay. AP in the house. Yep.
He has the hardest handshake I've ever had. I shook Adrian Peterson's hand. He came to ESPN.
Dude.
He almost broke my hand. And that's not even an exaggeration.
No, I believe it.
Like he grabs
that's
your
prime
hand
time.
Screams.
Well, that's actually not prime time, but that's, yeah, that's.
It's big time.
All day.
That's what it is.
Yeah. All right, 30 seconds. That's a long 30 seconds.
That was a long shot clock.
That was a long shot clock.
A long shot clock.
Somebody called timeout. Is that RC? Yeah, it is. The lights are blaring. I don't know if it's the lights or your holiness. It's
could
one or
both,
the other.
Right?
10, 9, 5.
Oh, wow.
4.
It's that math.
Yeah, 3, 2, 1. I'm Asian. You can't discount my math skills.
You said it, not me.
All right. All right. Hey, guys, give yourselves a round of applause. You guys are talking.
That's amazing. That's amazing. Who says men don't talk, huh? I love it. I love it. Well, guys, hey, I tell you what, in these last 10 minutes, closing minutes, we've kind of stumbled onto something that that is really kind of the men find really encouraging and enjoyable at the same time. It's kind of like a rapid fire Q&A. We've asked some men and a lot of the businessmen here. We have a lot of businessmen represented here, a lot of entrepreneurs represented here. In fact, how many of you guys are coming straight from the office? Go ahead and raise your hands if you're coming straight from the office, straight from work, right?
So that's awesome.
That's more than half. More than half of us. And a lot of them have sent in their questions. So I just want to kind of rapid fire. You haven't seen all these questions. So this is, some of this stuff is fresh. Some of this stuff we were kind of talking about earlier in the day. So let me just kind of go right into it, and and then we'll call it a night, okay?
Perfect.
This is going to be some high heat, so some of them are going to be kind of maybe personal. But
I'm a hacker. I go up hacking.
All right, great.
I'm looking
great.
To swing.
All right, two East Coast guys. All right. So, you know, Jason, you've worked at ESPN for 17 years.
Right.
You've seen a lot of personalities go through that place, right? You've seen athletes, coaches, you've talked about some of them, entertainers. You were mentioning earlier today, like Snoop Dogg, MC Hammer, you know, everyone, right?
Can you imagine MC Hammer walking around ESPN?
What's he doing in ESPN?
What is he doing? He's promoting
something. He's a
preacher,
actually, isn't he?
He is,
Like that. Anyway, we won't go there. But whose life of faith in Christ surprised you the most? Like, you're like, you didn't even know he was a believer or she was a believer, but like, you're like, whoa, you follow Jesus, you believe in Jesus, and like, they were legit. Who surprised you the most?
Well, there's two. The one that wasn't really a surprise, but kind of when you learn his story, was David Tyree. If you remember David Tyree, the helmet
catcher. That's a New York Giant.
It is.
This is not planned, guys. I promise you. I promise you.
I'm a Cowboys fan, so this is very hard for me to say.
Yes.
But he has the helmet catch, and he comes in, and all we talked about all day was his walk with Christ, and it was pretty impressive. I kind of knew that he was a believer, so it wasn't as shocking or surprising.
Okay.
But what a day spent with David Tyree, and he was at ESPN 3 days after he made that helmet catch, so everything was fresh.
This
it
cat,
was just
yes.
beat the Patriots and yes. won the Super Bowl.
That's called anointing. That's called anointing.
Whatever you want to call it. It's fine.
Okay, all right.
All right, the Giants won the Super Bowl. They got lucky.
Twice. Okay.
All right.
All right.
But the
Four
second guy.
Total. Okay, all right.
We're going to talk about the Giants the
Sorry.
Whole day, aren't we?
Go ahead.
The second guy will surprise
guy.
You. Now, anybody here grow up WWF fans, WWE fans, wrestling fans as a kid?
Ricky the Dragon Boat, Steamboat, or something?
Close, not bad.
Yeah.
Hulk Hogan.
No.
Hulk Hogan. So he comes to ESPN. I bring him to ESPN, much like Tony
Hulk
Dungy.
Hulk Hogan's a believer.
Hulk Hogan is a believer.
You will vouch for this.
Okay, it's what he told me. I mean, I can't tell you what he's doing the rest of his life, but that time, that moment, that's 4 or 5 hours I spent with him, he told me about his walk. He told me about how he was at the lowest point of his life, you know, basically wanted to kill himself, and he sat in a room, and a woman comes in, or a guy comes in, I don't remember who it was, and shares their faith with him, and he suddenly says, "You're right, I need to turn to Jesus," and he became a Christian. And I'm like, listen to this, like, what are you going, brother? Like, this is Hulkamania here.
Hulkamania,
you know?
Yeah, right.
Doing it, I say my prayers and eat my vitamins. Like, he really was saying his prayers. That's what I was thinking. Like, this guy loved Jesus. So,
I love
Hulk
that.
Hogan, of all the people.
I love
great.
That. Okay, awesome. I would be remiss if I didn't ask you, I just, like, this isn't necessarily, like, a faith question, and I know this is represented by a lot of guys. They're like, you got to ask him this.
Yeah.
What is Chris Berman really like?
Chris Berman, I love
Chris Berman. Rapid fire, just first things that come to your mind. Chris
he's
Berman.
Awesome, and I actually mentioned him in my goodbye note because I watched him just treat every single person that he came in contact with equally.
Rumbling,
from the janitor,
bumbling,
stumbling. From the janitor to the cafeteria person to the producer.
Love it.
He was awesome.
Skip Bayless.
Skip Bayless is the nicest guy you will
That's
ever
not
meet.
True. That's
I'm not even kidding.
Are you the first
I'm
take
not
guy.
Kidding.
Okay, Skip Bayless, you're saying is a nice guy.
Completely opposite from what you see on TV.
I actually heard as a believer.
I think he loves the Lord, yeah. I don't know that's that for
amazing.
A fact, but that's what I've heard too.
Stephen A. Smith.
Stephen
A. Smith.
He's exactly like he is on TV. And that's not a bad thing, because that's who Steve is.
That man's a
I've
preacher.
I've worked with him
There's
for years.
There's a preacher somewhere inside of
there
him.
There is. That guy could be preaching. He probably does think he's preaching every day
he's
on
from
first
Philly,
take.
Right?
He's from Philly, Jersey. I think he's more from New York City.
No, he's
area,
not from Jersey, man.
New York City, then.
Okay.
Yeah.
Philly.
But he's Stephen A. is a cool guy.
Dan Patrick.
Dan Patrick's cool. Like, that was the first guy I saw when I started my career at ESPN where I was just like, that's Dan Patrick.
trick.
Right.
Like, that was one of that moments.
Yeah.
And I was like, this is like.
He's been out of it for several years now.
He left ESPN, I want to say six, seven, eight years ago.
Okay, great.
And he's still on the air. He's on NBC.
Legendary.
He does the Olympics.
Legendary.
Well, he does. He's one of the great broadcasters of all time.
The late Stuart Scott.
Oh, I love Stu. I didn't get to know Stu really well. But, you know, when you're around production area, you see him. He used to come in and watch football with us on Sundays when we were watching the games. Stu was really, he was such a legendary figure.
Yeah.
He made the second phase of ESPN happen. Like, it was Chris Berman and Bob Lee that started.
Yes.
It was Dan Patrick and Stuart Scott that kind of carried
him into
the next
one. I got to say about Stuart Scott, he just seemed like very cool.
Yes.
Like a very, like a gentleman. He seemed like
his catchphrase was as cool as the other side of the
pillow. I love that phrase.
That was Stuart Scott. And I've gotten to know his family a little bit through family friends from my church, and they're genuinely really great people.
This is going to sound inappropriate, but I mean this respectfully.
Yeah.
He had a glass eye, and it wasn't the eye that looked like the glass eye, right?
Yeah, I believe that's what it was.
I just had to ask that for me. That was my
But there is an awesome tribute to Stu at ESPN, like a little sign that says Booyah, his catchphrase, and that's sort of an ode to Stu. You know, he was such a great dude. That day that he died was really tough to be at ESPN.
Oh, I bet.
Yeah.
I bet. Legendary.
Very.
I got to ask, Greeny and Golic, what are they like?
They're awesome.
Yeah.
I love Greeny and Golic.
Yeah. Yeah.
They gave me my start. You know, they gave me a platform and a show to be on in the beginning, and then I came back and ended my career at ESPN with them for my last year.
So
they are exactly like they are on the air. If you watch the show or if you listen, Greeny is this sort of nerdy guy who
plays
it well, but he genuinely loves sports. Both guys, I'll say this. This is the part that people don't see. They both genuinely love their families.
Oh,
they
love
their wives. They're back there with their wives constantly when the show is over. They love their kids.
That's manning up.
And I love seeing that through them. You know, they were what they were on the air, and they're fun off the air, too.
A little bit of the odd couple, those guys.
Very much the odd couple.
Yeah.
But them with their I've spent time with them with their families on the road at different remotes.
Awesome.
And I see that they are dedicated fathers and dedicated husbands, and that's the best thing I could say about them.
I want to kind of change gears here. A lot of times with Saddleback Men, a lot of talks that we've given, or whether we've gone to the wilderness retreat, or whether we're, you know, it's a man up event, we talk about the three deadly G's. I don't know if these guys realize it or not, but we do talk about that a lot. When I talk about the three deadly G's, I'm talking about gold, glory, and girls. These are the common temptations that we as men face. Doesn't even have to be a believer, but just men face these three deadly G's. Gold, glory, girls. Which of those three temptations do you feel like you encountered the most at ESPN, or was the most enticing at ESPN? Most prevalent?
Probably the gold. You know, I think I see a lot of people, and even for myself early on when I was telling you earlier about my identity was in my work, and I was so set on my job. I didn't spend a lot of time talking about, but you're always trying to get to the next level, to get promoted, to get seen by the right person, to have your work acknowledged, all that stuff, which we should have, you know, our work acknowledged. And when we get promotions, those are great.
Right.
But I see a lot of people chasing after the gold, after the opportunity to make more money. In 2008, I had an opportunity to become a producer, and they were going to pay me like $20,000 more than I was making at the time.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, after I kind of trained for a couple days, I came home, my wife asked me about it, and I said, I don't think I can take this job, honey. She's like, what do you mean? It's 20 grand more a year. I said, yeah, but they want me to work nights and weekends, and I'll never see you. My daughter was four, and I said, I'll never see her.
Right.
So I made the choice, that was just for me, not to take that job.
Yeah.
I said, I'll stay in the job I'm in, I'm comfortable, I'm fine, but I'll be around you, and I'll be able to watch my daughter go to school.
Gotcha.
In the morning and see her at night. So they're definitely chasing the gold, I think, because everybody, it's such a competitive place to want to impress and want to move up.
Right, right. And, you know, that's similar to, you know, the culture here in Southern California, right? I mean, this is one of the most affluent places, not just in the country, but in the world.
Yeah.
And so you're looking at a crowd of men here who, by and large, most of the world would consider this room right here some of the most successful men in the world. You can't afford to live, actually, here in Southern California unless you got some gold, so to speak.
Mm-hmm.
So it's interesting that you would say that, but then that's the very thing, because you were kind of sharing with me kind of behind stage earlier today that the step of faith that you took into ministry.
Yeah.
Well,
that wasn't about the gold, guys.
There ain't a lot of gold in ministry, right? Nobody goes into ministry to make money, as it were. And so kind of talk a little bit about that, just real quick.
I mean, I took about half my salary was cut. It was my salary was cut
50%.
In half when I left. ESPN to go into this ministry. Yeah. Initially, who knows what the Lord wants to do, right?
You must really love Jesus. You've got a daughter, you've got a wife.
Listen,
took a 50% salary cut.
I told you the story about getting to ESPN with my wife. Imagine the story of leaving ESPN right. with my wife. That's a whole other sermon.
That's the faith story.
That's a whole
other
sermon right there.
That's
guys.
Daring faith.
But that's the truth. Yeah. You know, and when you decide to go into ministry or pursue something, pursue your dream. Remember, I said I would take that ESPN job for a dollar. I wasn't kidding. Like, I would have gone to ESPN for free if they had called me, and I would have figured out how to live. Now it's the same thing with ministry. I really feel like this is God's time for me to step out in faith, and it's not about the money. Yes, we needed a certain amount of money to be able to pay our bills, and we needed to make wise decisions, and my wife and I prayed for this for a while to make sure that we were kind of going to be able to take this leap, but it's not about the money. It just wasn't. It's about
so good.
Bringing my skills and talents for a greater cause and a greater purpose.
So good. You know, again, we have a lot of businessmen here, a lot of people that are in the workforce, and some of the things that we talk about are best practices. ESPN is not only an industry leader. You guys literally created the industry. Before ESPN, sports news was like a five-minute clip on the local news, right?
True. Yeah.
But you created that industry. So I want you to address the men at work here. Oh, yeah, you did.
You're like, you created it.
You and Chris Berman.
Trust me. I was six when ESPN came on.
Right.
Six.
I want you to address the men at work here and share with us what are ESPN's, in your estimation, 17 years working there, what are the two best practices of ESPN?
Well, the one thing I could say is that they're not afraid to take risks. Hmm. You know, there was a time in 2006 when they, do you guys remember the ESPN phone? They came out with an ESPN phone called an ESPN mobile phone. Right. I remember I had one, and it rang when the Mets scored a run. I'm a big Mets fan. They score a run. My phone would actually send me an alert.
It didn't ring that much, though.
It didn't ring that much. Actually, in 06, it rang a lot. It rang a lot in 06. Didn't ring a lot after that. But ESPN took a risk by going into their own phone, and you were like, what are you doing?
Right.
It flopped. It blew up in their face. But ESPN mobile was born. So you guys now have the ESPN app on your phone, maybe you check scores and stuff.
Yeah.
That was birthed from the phone.
From a failure.
So they took a risk, they failed.
Love it.
But they took advantage of that failure.
Love it.
To learn something and create this amazing platform.
John Maxwell talks about failing forward all
correct.
The time, right?
And that's a very big practice is when you fail, guys, and we're going to fail.
Right.
Fail forward. So that's a best practice.
Guy
as good as I can say that.
A former, you know, Apple guy was just like, you know, just ship garbage. Just ship it out. Get it out there. Make even if it flops, it's okay.
Yeah.
You make mistakes. Pastor Rick says it all the time. He says
so
it to our staff all the time. He says, I want everyone on staff to make one mistake every single week. I make more than that. But
so
anyways.
But the other best practice real quick, guys, simply is networking. Meet as many people as you can, not only in the place you work, but outside of the place you work, because you never know when God calls you to say yes. And for me, having that network of people outside of ESPN allowed me to kind of take this leap and take this risk.
That kind of talks into your relationship thing that you were talking about before.
Yes.
Right? That's about networking is about relationships.
It's completely about relationships.
So two best practices I'm hearing, just go ahead, make mistakes, take
fail
risks.
Fail forward, man.
Fail forward and networking, relationships.
Build relationships.
I want you to share just an honest moment here. Mm-hmm. I don't want you to disparage a company that you worked for 17 years, but clearly, surely, you've seen other people in your networking, you've had relationships with other people in other industries. What is a practice that you saw at ESPN where you're like, you know what, that's not one of our best. Mm. We actually could improve on that. I see that being done better somewhere else. So in other words, what is a kind of, not worst practice, but what's something that you saw at ESPN that where you're like, we can improve?
It wasn't a bad practice by any means, but for me personally, I experienced a situation where I wasn't getting the feedback I needed to get.
Okay, feedback.
In order to do the job I needed to do. Now, we need feedback, right? We need to know how we're doing so we can improve or so we can continue to do the things that we're doing well. And for me, it was 07, 08, somewhere in there. I wasn't seeking out the feedback that I should have been seeking out. And then I got my year-end review and it was terrible. And we're like, what are you doing here?
Right.
Why are you doing this?
Caught
where is this coming
guard.
From? And I was just like, wait a minute. Not one time in the past year did you tell me that I was doing any of these things wrong.
Right, right.
And that's on them maybe to tell me that, but it's on me to seek that out. So it's not necessarily a bashing of ESPN by any amounts. I would never do that.
Yes.
But there's got to be some give and take, I think, from a management level, guys, to provide the feedback. And
that's
if from whatever level you're at, to reach out and ask for that feedback.
That's a good word. Just a couple more, and then we're going to send these guys out.
Sure.
Let me ask you this. you know, again, we're talking about ESPN. We're talking about an industry leader. Where does something like ESPN find their inspiration, their motivation, their creativity? Wow. I wanna pause by saying the reason I ask that is because a lot of times these Saddleback men, a lot of these guys have been coming here for years. Some of them have just started coming, and we tend to think here at Saddleback like, oh, you know, it's a big mega church, it's world renowned. We've got this amazing pastor. He writes books. He's known around the world. He hangs out with presidents and stuff like that. And so it's just like, oh, you know, they've been there, done that. They've quote unquote made it. Can be the perception. It's not a true one, but there's this perception like, oh, they know what they're doing. They can't learn from anyone. I would imagine with ESPN, like you guys, again, you're not just an industry leader. You created it. Where did you find your inspiration from as a company, as an organization?
Yeah, I think, you know, I can only speak from the places that I've worked in for the most part. But the inspiration that comes from a bunch of different areas. It could come from just making sure that you're present in meetings once a week, having just brainstorms. Like, we get so caught up in doing our job and doing our job that we never take a bigger picture look at what we're doing and saying, well, are we sure we're doing it properly or doing it the right way?
Gotcha.
The other areas are, we're watching the same people doing the jobs that we're doing. Mm-hmm. So for a while, I was a social media strategist at ESPN for the last 5 years, social media producer, whatever you want to call it. And so from a social media standpoint, we were watching Bleacher Report and Fox and CBS. But we were also
watching others.
We were watching other sports people, but we were also watching other news feeds.
Right.
And I was watching churches. I was watching Saddleback.
Oh, wow.
I was watching what content was being put on there, and I might get something from them and say, you know, we can do that in the sports
space.
Because
we're watching you, and we're like, yeah, we can do that. We can
exactly.
Do
so we're watching you guys as well. And I think that
that's awesome.
It's really just learning from our peers.
I love it.
And taking inspiration from them.
I love it. Okay, here's one. I know this is representative of many men here. I'll hear things like this as a pastor, as someone that's on the patio every weekend. I'll have a guy come up to me, and he'll be like, dude, you know, I'm a husband. I'm a father. You know, we never miss church. We're here during the weekend. We're in a small group. I spend like 60 hours a week at work. Yeah. Like, you know, and they're just tired. They're just exhausted. They're just they feel like they're not winning at home. They feel like they're not winning at the office.
Yeah.
Then they hear a guy from ESPN saying, you know, you got to do this and that. You got to be the salt and light. Speak to that man who is just so tired and hopeless and just exhausted right now.
I would say simply, it's okay to not be okay. I think that's all right. And acknowledging that is good. Because we guys like to hide stuff and stuff it down and think we're all right when sometimes we're not. And so it's okay to admit that and find somebody that you can talk to in that realm. I would also encourage you to be a light where you are. I think that's what I was trying to say when I was speaking earlier about what Jessica was telling me was, you know, bloom where you're planted. Mm. And, you know, we a lot of times want the grass to be greener. We might go to that area.
Yeah.
And my buddy back there just told me, he's like, sometimes we just need to water the grass where we're standing in and let that grow and not just look for the greener grass.
Mm.
And so I would encourage you to, it's okay to not be okay. And I would encourage you to kind of just find your comfort zone, your sweet spot, wherever you are in your place.
Mm-hmm.
And don't feel like you have to take on the burden of it all, because that's why we serve an almighty God that loves us so much and can take that burden for us.
There's a lot of hope in that. I love it. Last two questions. Yeah, amen.
Amen.
Last two questions. Last two questions. The second to last one here. What is your number one advice for a guy right now about how to integrate faith into the workplace besides checking off on your card, which I think is the last one.
Check off the card, guys.
Check off the card, okay? Besides that, they'll do that. Yeah. We'll receive those cards at the end. The ushers will do that.
Sure.
But besides that, what's your number one piece of advice for a guy right now about how to integrate faith in his workplace?
I'm going to just repeat what I said up here before.
Okay.
It's one word, guys, relationships.
Relationships.
That's the piece of advice. I mean, build the relationship. You may already have built those, and that's great. Keep doing that. But look to build relationships. Be intentional. Be intentional about building relationships, never forceful, but be intentional about your faith, but be intentional about building that relationships to get to your faith.
You might say purposeful.
Purposeful.
Yes.
Yeah. I've heard that word a few times.
We like the word purpose.
It's in
purpose.
A book somewhere. Yeah. I don't remember. Yeah,
exactly.
What book was that?
Right, so. Right. So be intentional with those relationships.
Yes. Be love purposeful it. Where you are with those relationships for sure.
Love it. Love it. Last question, Jason. Yeah. How can we stay in touch with you? I know you got different projects that you're working on. I mean, you're fresh out of ESPN. So, how can we stay in touch
with you? It's an exciting time for me. The best way, I just started about 6 weeks ago an email devotional where I simply send a note, an email of encouragement on Monday mornings. You know, we start our week and we're just like, oh, here comes Monday. And I put it in the email boxes at 5 a.m. It's probably two paragraphs. It shouldn't take you more than 3 minutes to read.
Right.
And it seems to be really taking off. A lot of people are interested in liking it. So I would encourage all of you guys, my email is right there. Email me, please.
Just jot it down in your notes.
Or tweet at me your email address.
Take a picture like that guy right there. Yeah.
Take a picture of it, whatever. But I would love to include you guys on this devotional. So that's one thing. I'm always on Twitter. I really am.
You really are
older more than I should be.
How many followers do you have again? You got
too many. Too many. Not enough.
Jesus has more, but you're
he does.
You're
not
up
as
there.
Many as Pastor Rick Warren, by the way. He's in the millions. But no, I enjoy Twitter so much. And if you're on there, I'm on Facebook and I'm on Instagram as well. So
that's
you can
actually
reach me.
How you and I met.
Yeah,
was on Twitter.
It was.
Right?
You tweeted at me.
Yeah.
But my website as well. But I just started something I want to share real quick, a podcast. So my next venture, I'm working with this company called Sports Spectrum. I'm writing some articles on sportspectrum.com. About the intersection of sports and faith. But this podcast, we're launching it Friday, like in 2 days.
This Friday.
Awesome. And we're going to, quickly I'll tell you, we're going to interview Marlins pitcher Adam Conley, and we're going to talk about how his faith in the workplace changed lives of people going through the worst tragedy you could go through. Remember when Jose Fernandez died last year, the pitcher of the Marlins?
Yeah, yeah.
So we go into the clubhouse and what that time was like, and that's the debut episode. And I'm really excited about this podcast because I think there's not a real place out there for the sports and faith world
kinda
to collide.
Intersect.
And so that's what we're trying to do. That's what I'm hoping to do. I would love for you guys to subscribe on iTunes. It's simply called the Sports Spectrum Podcast, or just search my name and it should come up on iTunes.
Awesome.
And I'm going to be tweeting about it a lot over the next 2 days, so you'll see it and posting it. But I would love for you to subscribe and listen and let me know what you think.
Good stuff. Saddleback men, can we give Jason a big hand?
Thanks, guys.
So good. Jason, here's what I want to do. I want to ask you to pray for the Saddleback men.
I would love
and
to.
Then after you pray, I'm going to pray for you, and I'm going to ask all the men to reach out your hand and pray for Jason along with me after he prays for us. Would you pray for the Saddleback men and all these men at work?
Let's bow our heads. Yes, sir. Father, we just come to you right now, and we say thank you. We say thank you for the blessings you've given us. Thank you for loving us right where we are, Lord, because we are all a mess, and we need you. So I thank you for that, Lord. I pray for every man in this room, Lord, that you would just minister to them, that you would open their eyes and open their hearts and give them the boldness and the courage to be intentional about their faith, to be able to build these relationships and to most of all be able to glorify you in the work that they do. So we pray for these men today, and we love you, Lord, and we thank you so much for all you've given us, for all you've done for us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Saddleback, man, would you reach out your hands towards Jason, and let's pray for him. Father God, thank you so much for our brother and our friend Jason, Lord. Thank you for what you're doing in his life. Thank you that he was sensitive enough to your Holy Spirit, who was nudging him a certain way out of a place of comfort, out of a place of even a celebrity, you know, prominent status, into a place of serving, of actually serving. And just, Father, as a man, as a husband, as a father myself, I just look at that number 50% less, and I'm just like, no, I can't do it. I can't do it. But you use someone even like our pastor, Pastor Rick, to remind him that faith means risk. And to take this daring step of faith. And he's just a month into it. He's just 2 months into it. So I pray, Father, that you would embolden his heart, give him strength, give him courage to walk faithfully. I pray that you would protect him, Lord. I pray that your spirit would continue to guide him. And I pray that anything that he said tonight that would have encouraged any man in this room, any man listening online, Lord, that you would take that and cause it to grow. Help us to be men of courage. Help us to be men of strength. Help us to be men of faith and of conviction, Lord. And it's in Jesus' name all God's men said,
amen. Amen.
God bless you guys. We'll worship with one last song. So good to see you guys.
Thank you. Amazing, amazing. It's so great sharing that together. You know, on your way out, make sure that you turn in the bottom part of your response card because we would love to hear from you and connect with you. And also, don't forget, next man up is April 26th. So mark your calendars and be here with us. We'll see you then.